In 1854, near the town of St. Mary's, Ohio, a love triangle would bring one man to commit murder. The horrific killing would happen on the bridge that stands right behind me and would be seared into the town's memory. This plaque next to me was erected in 1976 by the Auglaize County Historical Society to commemorate that terrible night. Join me as we explore this legend and discuss the strangest twists so far in this series. To the Least Professional channel on YouTube, and welcome to Ohio Legends and Tales. Today we are just off State Route 66 in western Ohio between St. Mary's and Spencerville in a spot known as the Bloody Bridge. At first glance, this just seems to be a normal bridge, but upon closer inspection, you'll notice a plaque with the story of Minnie Warren, Jack Billings, and Bill Jones. Now the river that the bridge crosses over is actually part of the Miami and Erie Canal, one of the many canals that were used as highways in the 19th century to move goods and people all around the state. Our story starts in 1854, the height of the canal era in the state of Ohio. Jack Billings and Bill Jones both worked as mule drivers for canal boats that would pass through the canal under the bridge right behind me. Many canal boats used a team of two mules to pull them along the canal. The mule driver was responsible for taking care of the animals and guiding them along the side of the canal to pull the boat along. The life of a mule driver consisted of long days walking alongside the mules as they pulled the canal boat at speeds of around 2 miles per hour. Boats could travel as far as 35 or 36 miles in a single day. Jack Billings worked on the canal boat named Daisy, and Bill Jones worked on the canal boat called the Minnie Warren, named after the daughter of the captain. The captain's daughter, Minnie, was said to be a beautiful young woman, and Jack and Bill were both trying to win her affection. Over time, Minnie found herself falling for Jack, and they began to see each other exclusively. The rivalry between Jack and Bill grew more and more bitter. It was said that they would crack the whips on their mules just a little bit harder when passing on opposite sides of the canal. Jack would also make it a point to blow kisses at Minnie as they passed, just to spite Bill. In the fall of 1854, both the Daisy and the Minnie Warren were docked at a lumber yard near the Bloody Bridge to pick up a load of lumber that was being shipped. It would take a few days to load the lumber, giving Jack, Bill, and Minnie time to get acquainted with some of the local residents. One of the young women that they met invited them to a house party that was happening the night before they were scheduled to leave. The day of the party came, and though Jack and Minnie were very excited to get to spend time together, Bill was furious that he would not have the chance to spend time alone with Millie. All three of them set off for the party early in the evening, though only Jack and Minnie would stay for the whole party. An evening of games gave way to dancing and laughter for everyone in attendance. It would go on into the wee hours of the night, and when they were so tired they could barely walk, Jack and Minnie would set off for the docks after bidding their new friends a good evening. Now the stroll back to the boats was peaceful, full of sounds of the crickets chirping and the stars dancing overhead. They knew that once the morning came, they would be setting off on their separate trips and may not see each other again for days or even weeks. As they drew near the docks, they came upon a bridge, and in the darkness and their infatuation, they failed to notice a figure standing on the opposite side of it. As they began crossing the bridge, the figure would step out of the shadows and reveal itself to be Bill. Bill would let all of his anger out, screaming at the couple as he moved closer and closer. It was reported that he would yell, "Ho ho, my pretty pair, you have played it fine tonight, but my turn comes now." Suddenly, they would see the glint of the moonlight above reflect off an object in Bill's hands. Before they knew what was happening, Bill would raise an axe above his head and bring it down in a swift swing. In a split second, the axe would make contact with Jack's neck and cut clean through. As Jack's head and lifeless body came tumbling to the ground, Minnie would let out a shriek. Fearing for her life, she would fall to the ground and began to scramble away. In her haste, she failed to see where she was going and fell into the canal below to her death. As people nearby came running to see what had caused the scream, Bill would flee into the night. Minnie's lifeless body was pulled from the canal and that she and Jack were buried next to each other in a nearby cemetery. Bill would go missing, and many years later, it was speculated that a skeleton recovered from a local well was his. Some said he had committed suicide upon realizing what he had done, and others said that vengeance had been carried out in the dead of night by those seeking justice. It is said that Jack's blood stained the bridge so deep that it could be seen for years following that night. Many people claim to have seen a headless figure standing on the bridge in the darkness, or they say they've looked over the side of the bridge into the canal below, only to see the pretty young face of Minnie staring back at them. But here's where our story takes a strange turn. There's been a lot of debate over whether this event ever even happened. While researching the story, I was unable to find any record that Jack Billings, Bill Jones, or Minnie Warren ever existed. I was able to find several newspaper articles of the story. The earliest was in the Akron Daily Democrat from December 10, 1894. Others included the Richwood Gazette from September 5, 1895, the Journal News out of Spencerville, Ohio on March 12, 1925, and that same paper on May 18, 1939. With the exception of a few minor grammatical differences in the 1939 version, all four stories were the exact same, word for word. Even the final paragraph about the bridge being torn down is the same, with the notable exception of the 1939 version changing to say the bridge was torn down in 1904. I will put them up on the screen with the years that they were written so that you can see what I found. I reached out to the Allglades County Historical Society to see if they could shed some light on historical records that may exist to verify the story is true, but I haven't received a response yet. If I do hear back, I'll let you know. I also discovered one of the biggest twists in a story that I have found so far. The bridge behind me was actually built in 1893. It was rebuilt in 1996 to make it safe for travel and to bring it more in line with modern bridges. The map of the area that I found from 1860 actually points to the correct bridge for the story being just a little further south, near where a lumber mill actually stood. That makes a little more sense in context with the story, since they were docked at a lumber yard and there's a bridge that's right there, as opposed to this area where there wasn't a bridge on the map and there wasn't a lumber yard. The closest lumber yard would have been a little bit further north. Okay, so here's what I think happened. Someone wrote a fictional story sometime in the late 1800s in the local area. That story was shared and published in various small newspapers all around the state of Ohio. The story became so ingrained in local lore that it became a part of the history of the county. And by the time the Historical Society was established in 1963, the story had become one of many that was just believed to be true. When I first heard this story, I found it really interesting. Most of the sources that I checked failed to mention the fact that the story itself is disputed as history or merely a legend, but a few did mention it. Now, I have a lot of really cool stories I'm working on for the coming weeks. This episode was about an event that may or may not have happened. But next week, we'll be taking a look at a town that no longer exists, but is full of tales that did happen. So make sure to hit that like button if you enjoyed the video, and subscribe so you don't miss out on any of the exciting episodes I have coming up. There's a whole playlist of these Legends and Tales videos to check out if you want to dig in and get spooked. So click on the playlist right over here to get caught up or revisit your favorite episodes. I want to thank you all for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.